Dahl probably wrote Mr. Fox to be an animal version of himself. When we were writing it, we sort of, without ever putting into words, that was sort of intuitively what we were doing. We spent time at his house while we were writing, and a lot of the details of his life sort of found their way into our story and into his character.
Wes said, you know, whenever we can, let's just bring Dahl into this and let's use him as an inspiration. It's kind of like we're trying to bring him to life in the spaces that we're building here.
It was no question Gypsy House influenced him, I think, enormously. I think he felt close to Rahl here. Every book Rahl wrote, every draft of every book, is in the archives in the museum in the village. He was able to look at early drafts of the book, and also the most enchanting notebook that Rahl did and illustrated himself. All those things moved him greatly, I think. He said, I'd like the look of the film to be like Donald Chaffin's illustrations. Donald Chaffin was the first person to illustrate Fantastic Mr. Fox. And on the cover of that book, there is the tree. So I said to Wes, well, actually, the real tree exists, and it's just a little way up the lane from Gypsy House. It's a big beech tree, which was amazing. About a year later, sadly, this 150-year-old tree fell. It just collapsed into the field and is now horizontal rather than vertical and covered in brambles. But, you know, trees have lives.
Some of those images literally resonated in Wes's mind since he had this book as a child and have kind of come back to life. And in fact, we even contacted the illustrator. He came over and visited us, and he thinks for us on the film, because we were like, well, these images in some ways were an inspiration.
He wrote in a small hut in the orchard, some quiet, sacred place. It's very cozy and it's very basic. And that's what he loved. Typical Wes. It's Fantastic Mr. Fox's office. And he's even gone as far as making the little, there's a little yellow porcelain mug with Staffordshire mug, actually, an antique one that he kept his pencils in. He's copied everything.
By the end of the film, we'll have about 120 sets, unique sets, which is quite an undertaking. If you're working on a live-action film, you'd find environments that you liked, and then you might build sets for interiors and such, but we have to come up with everything from scratch. That in itself is quite an undertaking.
He's a great one for prop direction, Wes. He's fanatical, I think, about prop placement. We can spend 24 hours placing small props on the edge of frames and making sure things have got the right design painted on them and things like that. That's a very Wes thing. I think if you look at Life Aquatic, the art direction is really there. And I think that's what he's bringing to this.
Wes didn't know how much work it was going to be when he started out, but he's embraced it because, you know, he loves his work, and he loves, I think, the idea that he can really create every bit of the image that's on the screen. Someone who comes from a live-action background, you're used to a set dresser having a bunch of things sitting on a table, and you say, well, what could we put on this table? And they'll pull out, well, we've got this vase or this coffee cup. And here, we're having to think about that in advance, and he'll say, you know, okay, well, let's make a coffee cup that looks like the coffee cup that I saw in this restaurant in New York, and we can create that. And I think that ability to really sculpt the image on every level is, for someone who's so visual, it's daunting, but it's an amazing process.
Many, many objects that are in the film are from Gypsy House. Wes had every lampshade, every object in the house photographed, and then chose what he wanted and had little miniatures made of them.
My favorite sets by far are the interiors, especially the Fox family home. When we first see the home, it's unfurnished, and he's thinking about renting it. And after they move in, they do a lot of work. They're so rich and textured and patterned. They're very beautiful and very intimate. And again, quite odd and unique. It's going to be really quite a beautiful set.
Our idea of the movie was that it was going to take place in autumn, for there to be mud. The whole movie takes place in the mud. This didn't really happen. Mud is not easy in stop motion. We ended up having no green and almost no blue. If you take green and blue out, it looks like this.
It's a very cozy, very warm look. It's very real, if you like. Puppets benefit a lot from modeling, you know, from making them stand out from the background, because they're not human beings. Human beings have got highly reflective eyes, their skin takes light in a certain way, and you haven't got that with puppets. You have to make them stand out in a different way. So the way you light them is very specific to what they're made of. And these are made of fur, not clay, so I had to find a way to do that. This particular scene is very special in the film because it's set in a cider cellar, and the brief was that it should be self-illuminating. So all the light in the cellar comes through the bottles as if the bottles themselves are alight. If you move a bottle just half an inch, a couple of centimetres, it'll go dark because the light isn't refracting through it in the right way. So every single bottle you see on those shelves has been placed and moved so that the light comes through it in the right way. And every time we move the camera, we have to re-lens a number of those bottles so that there aren't dark patches behind. So it's quite fun in that way to make that sort of rather special environment work.
It's kind of a unique take of a Roald Dahl story. It's both very naturalistic in some ways and then very sort of artificial and contrived in others. We're really expecting people to take on board the fact that there's a badger dressed in a very nicely styled business suit sitting behind a big oak desk inside of a law office, and we're treating it kind of seriously. So it's a very strange mix.
We've had this kind of idea that let's try and keep the handmade quality to keep this really fun to look at. So we've been trying to do things like a lot of the special effects smoke and things like that. We've been doing them with cotton wool and trying to keep it feeling very organic. But at the same time, that doesn't mean that this is going to look like, you know, some kind of after-school arts and crafts project. We're doing that at a very, very high level so that it really, at the same time, would be something that your average person is not even going to think about, okay, this is how it was done.
Those things are always a challenge because you have to stylize them somewhat and then figure out, you know, how far you're going to chase reality. And they take time. You know, when you have big scenes full of smoke and fire and you're trying to do that smoke just with cotton wool in front of the camera, it is really difficult, but fun, and ultimately I think it's very interesting to look at.
It's very lavish and very detailed and yet very restrained in a lot of ways. He's created sort of a very tight sort of spectrum in which we could do this film, both with detail, color, patterns, overall look. And so I think we've come up with something that's quite unique because of that.
Everything magically seems to look better than we could have pictured it or that I could have pictured it. There's always sort of, you come up with an idea and you think, well, maybe this is a bit crazy, we're going to try and do this, or really hope it works out. And then when we've seen it realized, it's been like, you know, wow, it really did work. These worlds and these images and the animation and these characters are really coming to life. Every prop, every little thing is like made by someone who's just an expert artist.
Such an English book. So I was slightly surprised when they cast George Clooney and Meryl Streep in the leading roles. I'm delighted. I think they've done the most fantastic job. And I think they're rather good together. Roald's books, they're international. Immediately, I was a bit shocked. I thought they could be English voices. But when it's done, it's wonderful. It makes no difference at all.
Darling, that's right where it's going to land.
Don't. Let's go.
No, it just falls straight right down.
Wes called me one day. I remember I was driving down the street and he called me and it was pouring rain. I ended up having to pull over because I was like, I don't think I can do this phone call in the blinding rain. He said, I just think, he was like, who should we get for Mr. Fox? Who is today's, you know, Cary Grant? In about like an eighth of a second, we both said George Clooney.
Are you scared of wolves?
Scared? No. I have a phobia of them.
Well, I have a thing about thunder.
Why? That's stupid.
George Clooney personifies exactly the type of role. He does the right amount of charming and sort of sly. At the same time, he can be a little self-deprecating, you know, if he wants to be.
It's so inspiring for animators to have a voice like that to work with, because when you start with the color and the nuance that's in his voice, and then they're completely inspired. They can do even greater things.
I'm gonna tape this for my records, so don't make a lot of sounds. I mean, stop rocking.
The thing about George is he can be humorous and funny at the same time as he's cool. I think that's what we needed for Mr. Fox, for people to kind of love him, but also know that he's a little bit flawed, and to laugh at him, but also be with him. And that's a delicate balance, especially in animation.
We recorded the voices in kind of an unconventional way, which was we went to a farm and kind of got a group together, and he was happy to do that, which I really appreciated because it made it, we were able to kind of do what I set out to do in terms of the way we the performances would be recorded, and it made fun.
Wes's dream was to keep the actors as close together as possible with one microphone and have them run around and act out these scenes so you could get people out of breath, overlapping each other. Things that happen in real movies that you tend not to see typically in animated films because things are done so separately. If the foxes are digging a hole, Wes got us on the ground and actually had us digging in the ground. And the microphone is going like this everywhere. And I mean, if you had filmed us from a distance doing the scenes to this movie, you'd think it was really funny and entertaining.
Do you really think you want to cuss with me?
I will cuss you up.
How'd you like your cussing paws ripped off?
I will cuss you in half.
We did it all out in nature. No one's ever done anything like that. You know, we're in different barns, different parts of the farm, different atmospheres to get different sound quality and different feel when you're performing. You can tell when you read a script, the guy who wrote this is going to direct it. He knows exactly what he wants to do. So I felt that way about it from the beginning, that I just sort of suspended any disbelief. It was a good leap on my part. I think it's a wonderful movie.
Well, I guess we should probably split into a certain number of groups and start doing something, right?
And all the movies are wonderful. And I've gotten to work with some wonderful actors. He selects great actors to work with.
Just on the other side of this mineral deposit, follow me. I'm gonna lose my temper now.
Well, when we heard that we had the possibility of getting Meryl Streep for the film, everyone was just so excited because she's sort of the quintessential mom. Like, she's got such a lovely, warm, caring voice. And yet also, you know, this character has a real independent spirit. She's a bohemian sort of painter and really thinks for herself. And so the strength that Meryl also brought to the role was really, you know, just so important.
The thing with Meryl Streep is she's obviously sort of the most highly thought of actress on the planet. But when we're there to do the scene together, she's perfectly happy to start, you know, acting crazy to see if this helps to bring it to life. And, you know, making sounds and just pretending, using her imagination in some recording studio. They were looking at this thing on the page and saying, let's try it again, and now she's kind of yelling and acting like an animal. And the result is you get something very alive.
You really are kind of a quote-unquote fantastic fox.
I try.
She has a beautiful voice, and she really knows how to use it. You really get everything you're hoping for with somebody like that.
Do you think I'm an athlete?
What are you talking about?
Well, you know, I think I'm an athlete, and sometimes I feel like you guys don't see me that way.
What's the subtext here?
Well, my character, Ash, I'm the son of George Clooney and Meryl Streep. Right? Obviously.
Go! Ah, Raza!
Watch this, Dad!
Well, well.
Good jump, Ash. Remember to keep your tail tucked.
He doesn't really know who he is, and he wants his father's love and his mother's love, but really his father's love and approval. I want to be a great athlete like my dad. I want to be smart like him. I want to be a fox. I want to be a man fox. What makes Mr. Fox so fantastic is just that maybe all foxes are fantastic. Maybe everyone's fantastic. You just have to realize you're fantastic. When you're a teenager, you feel so odd and awkward, and you feel ashamed or weird about things and being who you are, and it turns out that's what makes you great.
I can fit through there. You want to know why?
Why?
Because I'm little.
We're all naturally born with some kind of a weird gift. You know, you can chew through wood, and you're small enough to scurry through a hole, and these are all things that make us unique and different and odd and also special and beautiful.
But there's something kind of fantastic about that, isn't there?
When you find source material that is so wonderful and resonates with generations of children and families, there is something there that's special and universal and unique that you want to really retain. So to change that or to somehow not do it service seems counterproductive. It's like, that's why we love this story.
The story is a great story, but it's very short. It's sort of a one-act type of story. So to turn it into a feature, Wes and Noah, who we wrote the script with, had to develop it into a full-length story.
I had an idea of where it could start that's before what we experienced in the book. We wrote that, and then at a certain point, we said, now we're arriving at the book, and then we followed the book. And then at the end of that, we had an idea immediately, okay, something else happens right now.
Cider.
I don't remember it being much of a struggle. It almost felt like the book was ready to have other, to be a trilogy.
The spirit of the source material is there. A lot of the original dialogue, there's directly dropped in lines. They came from the doll text.
We got the tail, but we missed the fox.
Obviously, there's whole scenes and scenarios and characters that we've expanded that did not exist in the book.
Let's see some hustle.
I think Wes has definitely written them, you know, in a doll-esque way, but also in very much his voice, because, you know, he's adding something to it as well.
You should probably put your bandit hat on now. Personally, I don't have one, but I modified this tube sock.
We look good.
Yeah, we do.
What this film has going for it is Wes Anderson's sensibility. That's what's going to set it apart from any other animated film or stop-motion film in particular. His very, very specific ways that he likes to shoot films and see performances done.
Contact! Good. And try one that's got a contact!
Sure.
Stanky.
Stanky,
please. Contact! Good.
The other thing that he embraced from the point of view of animation was, okay, let's see if I can just sort of approach this in the way that I would approach a live action film, and the way I would shoot the shots, the way I would block the scenes, and see if that plays in animation. It's easier to get emotion out of a real human being than out of a puppet, and there's certain conventions in animation that help storytelling that, you know, that are very useful. But I think where he could, he tried to say, well, let's just follow the process I would follow in a live action movie and just do it, you know, 100 times over, because that's what you have to do in animation.
Wes has very strong ideas. He's a designer as much as he is a director of the film. He has such a clear direction on the way he wants things to look. They are not very stop frame friendly in a way, which is a good challenge for me. So I had to sort of take his unique, sort of dry, slightly adult kind of vision and make it into a stop frame world.
Doing this sort of movie, it's a long, long process. And it's very detail-oriented. There's a million decisions, more than a normal movie, many more than a normal, than a live-action movie. Because everything has to be made to be in there. It's miniature, and people are making decisions not in a moment-to-moment basis in the story, but in a frame-to-frame basis, and everything is just more intricate. In order to manage that, we found is you have to develop highly functional systems. Half of the process of making the movie was figuring out how to make the movie and how to manage all this information and to make sure that we get onto the screen what we want to get on there.
Wes and I are in touch many, many times a day. Part of the challenge of this job is trying to communicate his unique sensibilities from a performance point of view or art direction point of view to the animators so that we're making a Wes Anderson film in every way.
The first thing that he did is he went through the script and he drew little thumbnail storyboards of pretty much every scene in the movie. Little tiny sketches that, you know, were quite simple but also kind of showed quite clearly the type of framing and world that he wanted to create. The next thing we did is we storyboarded the film with professional storyboard artists and edited that to the voice performances that had been recorded. Those were edited together with the storyboards, and that became our animatic.
Good job, Ash. Remember to keep your tail tucked.
The animatic edited together with the voices, with the instructions we had from Wes, we sort of brought on set and started to shoot the movie. It became clear right at the beginning that, you know, Wes had very, very specific ideas of how he wanted the puppets, the puppet actors and the animators, to animate these puppets.
There, he goes away from the camera to the first of the thousands and thousands of chickens. He picks it up slowly,
And it wakes up and he goes, right when it wakes up.
Wes obviously had his idea of what how he wanted the shot to be. So how it sort of worked was he would do these videos of him acting out the script, basically. So he would play the part.
Because am I?
He had a very, obviously, a specific idea of what he wanted it to be. And it was usually quite clear as to very precise sort of facial mannerisms or gestures that the animator could then work with and pick out, you know, sort of key elements that he wanted in there. And obviously, from that point, that was a good basic sort of starting block for where the animator was going to go. Sometimes with the live action videos, they're actually multi-screened ones, so you'd have maybe five Wes's in the shot, you know, sort of playing out all the different parts that you put all together. You could probably get a film of Wes acting everything out, which would be great.
I can see when he's walking around here with the animators, you know, he suggests ideas that they've never heard before. You know, he does spin things on their heads. And I also see that what I'm sure would have been some sort of initial reaction or resistance, they now get excited when he walks in the room, and because they've all got it. Everyone's got the feel of it.
There's 29 units going at once. That's insane. I'm accustomed to one, and that's usually completely overwhelming. We have such a great group of people. Some of the best people doing animation in the world are here with us in London working on the movie. I was new to it, so I had so much to learn from all of these different people. And then our process is different from what they've done because of just the way that, just working with me. So we really had a lot to figure out, and I feel like we did.
Can you do the signature?
Yeah. What's that?
He's heavy.
Yeah, he's got quite a quite a big character, and he's got a lot of
metal. I like that his nose sort of like his eyes are sort of inside of his nose. And his eyes are so close together, they've got to really work to get around the side to see around his nose.
In the way that any lawyer-client relationship is going to get strained, especially if one is sort of just working the edges of the law, like the Fox is. I mean, it's true enough that most people don't take advice anyway. And a guy who gives advice for a living probably is more aware of that than most.
I think you just got to not do it, man. That's all.
I understand what you're saying, and your comments are valuable, but I'm going to ignore your advice.
The cuss you are.
The cuss am I? Are you cussing with me?
No, you cussing with me?
Don't cuss and point
at me. You're
going
to cuss with somebody. You're not going to cuss with me.
I originally tried to do it with a Wisconsin accent because the badger is the mascot of the University of Wisconsin. So I worked on my Wisconsin accent very hard. I listened to National Public Radio, the Wisconsin channel, for days driving around the car listening to this voice. And I did the first few takes, first few scenes with the Wisconsin voice, and I was feeling really pleased, you know. And I said, so what do you think about that? Huh? I mean, what do you think about that? And he said, well, I really see him as sort of a Savile Row lawyer kind of a badger.
Okay.
I didn't see him as a Savile Row lawyer kind of a badger. I don't think you would have either. That's kind of the deal. That's how I saw him.
We just got one little thing, which is a gift for you.
Oh, that's so nice.
You have to be on the crew to get one of these, so soon as you're on the team.
That is beautiful.
You can feel part of the puppet hospital now.
Beautiful.
Thank you. I'm proud of this. This is really good. I like this a lot. It's an amazing amount of work. There's so many people working here. They're working so hard. Just hundreds of people that just work, you know, in fine, fine detail. It's nice to go in and say, tell me how you do this. How do you do this? How do you make this thing happen? Because it is a real magic that they do.
Okay, let's go somewhere else. Learn more about the animation process. Kim is one of our top animators, I would say.
Really? Should I be getting in good with you? Hey, come here. I want you to make me look really good in my close-up.
This is Wes Anderson, the director of The Fantastic Mr. Fox. And this is Kim Kukulair, who we just call Kuki Kim, who is 120 years old and looks fantastic. Look at the shape she's in for 120. What a nice figure. You get all that animating?
Yeah.
It's really good, just twisting these people into the shape they are. She's emailing someone, he's here, someone come and help me. The boss is here, he's probably coming to your set next, hurry up. We're here in the sewer cavern where all the critters have just been flooded out of their home.
and they've ended up down in this sewer. You can see how everyone's just a little bit moist, a little bit that I just escaped something terrible. Look.
What just happened? Something with cider. That was dangerous. Is anyone hurt?
How much time in the film is this going to take? Is this going to occupy?
This is 18 seconds shot.
18 seconds.
Yes.
So you can imagine all you freaks at home, they have like a small train set, and the amount of time it takes you to glue a bush down, how long it's going to take these people to get these 18 seconds worth of footage.
But how long will it take to do the 18 seconds,
Kim? It took
Kim?
Me 8 days.
Eight days, and we're on the ninth day now.
Yes, yeah.
Before we go any further, from now on, can you give me some kind of a signal once in a while just so I know any of this is getting through to you?
It's just a series of individual photographs taken of this, right?
Yeah.
So how many photographs make up a second? How many photographs in a second?
I take 24 photographs.
Per second?
Yeah, per second. But you animate, we animate on double. So we making a position with the puppet, and then we're taking two photographs.
That are the same?
Yeah, the same.
So it's 12 poses a second, unless you want to move fast.
Really fast, if there is a really fast action.
Someone's running or something.
Yeah,
then it's 24. To make a puppet just stand there staring is very hard to do, because if you don't move them, it seems like a still. Mm-hmm. And if you move them, they start doing things like this.
The most difficult thing is to keep puppet alive when they completely still.
Choose to do an impression of a puppet looking completely still.
You nailed it.
Is there any way you could come to my house and help me straighten up my desk? I mean, if you could plan all this out, I bet you could figure out what's supposed to be thrown out.
Even though it's stop motion animation, it has all the quirkiness and the attention to detail that all his films have. You know, so it's delightful to watch. It's delightful to walk through and see and just laugh, because you know that he intentionally made, you know, that bottle look like this, you know. He intentionally made this bottle look like this, you know, in giant size. I think our guys here have taken the technique to a new place.
And this is Mark Waring, who is the supervisor of all animation. So we're not going to fire anybody, but tell us some stuff. Inform us, educate us right now. I need to know more. I'm looking at your street here, and it looks like, as you say, it looks like cotton balls that have been colored, but it's smoke when you do it here. How do you make it? How do you make it? Do you just wave it? Do you push it? What do you do?
Yeah, sort of. It's cotton wadding that's it's been sprayed to give it a sort of darker tone, and then you can tease it out bit by bit to actually to pull it. So as you animate it frame by frame, then you get a sort of slight drift on it, so you can just pull it up.
How about something else? Show us how you do the fire.
This is clear soap that's been carved. You can smell it.
Smells good.
Yeah. So you can and we carve that, and then they're just replaced. So we just take them away, replace them with another one.
So it just gets
a flickering, leaping flame effect. So that combined then with the smoke, so you get a sort of a fire smoky effect with sort of basic influence.
He's going to show us how water comes out of a hose. It's cellophane.
It's cellophane.
And you wrap it around a little piece of wire, like soldering iron or something. Solder or something, right?
Yep. Again, like the soap, so you replace bit by bit. But that is the basic idea. So that'll come
out.
So
it's basically that same piece, and then you can fold it a different way.
Yeah, you can fold it and pull it and twist it. And it just
changes the way the light hits
it. Yeah, just a light reflection in it.
People really commit to the project, and for people that have been on a movie for 2 years, they act like they just got started. I mean, people are just as zealous about it as any time during the film. It's supposed to end in 2 weeks, but they don't act that way. They don't look like they're ground down or wound down. They have they've got an impishness in their eyes. They think the whole story is a wonderful opportunity for them to show off what they do. I mean, there's some serious showing off going on.
See y'all later.
Well, you gotta be taking the eyes.
Thanks everybody. Thanks everybody at the Academy.
Our idea of the movie was that it was going to take place in a landscape that was like Gypsy House, which is Dahl's house, that part of England.
He loved the countryside. He loved the woods. They go right through his books. And of course, particularly in Fantastic Mr. Fox.
We take the shortcut or the scenic route?
Let's take the shortcut.
Oh, but the scenic route is so much prettier.
Okay, let's take the scenic route.
Wes came to Gypsy House, and then he said, would you mind if I came and stayed to write the screenplay? He said, I think I'll feel the atmosphere. And I said, no, I'd be delighted.
I started working with Noah Baumbach on the script, and I had an idea of where it could start. We just followed it through.
I think his books are perfect for making into films. We have the most enchanting notebook that Rod did and illustrated himself. He had the foxes pushing the supermarket trolleys. All those things moved Wes.
And a lot of the details of his life sort of found their way into our story and into his character.
I'm going to tape this for my records, so don't make a lot of sounds. Meaning stop rocking.
Dahl probably wrote Mr. Fox to be an animal version of himself. As a result of that, Dahl is a very interesting man, and so that went into the character.
Here we are. Wow.
He's copied everything. Wes had every lampshade, every object in the house photographed, and had little miniatures made of them. God, what a team they had. The first time I went, I just burst into tears. I mean, it was so emotional for me because they'd caught so many of Roar's characteristics, which are slightly in Mr. Fox, and just an atmosphere of what he was trying to create in the book.
Honey, I'm 7 non-Fox years old now. My father died at 7 and a half. I don't want to live in a hole anymore. And I'm going to do something about it.
My breath was taken away, I have to say. It's fantastic. I can feel him smiling. When I was watching it, I thought, he'd love this.
I love you, Felicity.
I love you too.
It was very exciting to work this way and see what, you know, all these people make with their hands to tell the story. It's very beautiful just to watch somebody doing that.
My name's Andy Gent. I'm head of puppets on Fantastic Mr. Fox. The whole process for us starts with a design drawing. We've had a team of people working on character design and development with Wes, doing illustrations and pre-vising all of the characters.
We started with real animals and a couple of sketch artists and just did a lot of drawings and presented those to Wes. He started narrowing down the search for these characters. I think we're always keeping in mind the actors who were playing the characters. We did a lot of maquettes, a lot of sketches, and finally brought them down to the essence of the characters that you see in the finished film.
After quite an extensive amount of character drawing, we'll start to block them out in plasticine, so we'll actually then turn them into a three-dimensional sculpt. As we sort of get to a good shape with things, we'll start to add more detail to it, more textures, until it's a fully finished sculpt with all of the details, basically all the character in. Once we've got it into a nice shape, we'll remove all the sort of sculpted clothes to get the bare parts of the puppet. And then we'll do a mould for it that we can then subsequently get the finished armature out and the finished silicone or foam latex or combination puppet. This is a basic armature. All of these things are the hard sort of mechanical parts that go underneath. So once you've got the sculpt, we can fit these in so we can hit where all of the joints would hit onto a skeleton and start building it up. And then, when we're happy with that and it fits perfectly to the mold, we'll start making these little grip points and shapes that fit onto the armature so the animators can feel where things are, and it helps the costumes not be crushed too much and keeps the weight down of the puppet as well, so it sort of blocks it all out. We do have, which is particular to this, an awful lot of different scales.
Those guys are going to work soon.
Yeah, they're really, really nice.
Yeah, they do.
We're pleased with those.
Here we have different scale characters. So this is a full scale Mr. Fox and Mrs. Fox Badger. Then here's our half scale puppets, which we can use for different size of sets. And then sometimes we'll use these micro scale puppets. Whereas the full scale mouse is about the same size as the micro badger, as you can see. But there's also this scale, which is the, we say, mini micro, which can be used for very, very wide shots. This little puppet can be animated.
We've had some new joints, which are incredibly small, so 1.6 mil doubles as well. Affectionately known as. But they'll go into some of the smaller parts, and then we might use some wire with that to get the rest of the puppet to move. But when you get down to our really tiny puppets, the mini micros, they're just a little wire armature, and they're not much bigger than your sort of thumbnail, but they help us get these truly enormous sort of set pieces out.
Wow, look at that thing. It's got all these little pieces, these little joints, really, aren't they?
Yeah, so it's sort of a little
can
bit.
Can I make it dance or what?
You can, yeah, you should be able to move him around.
How the hell?
It's got wire legs and arms.
Man, oh man, so now what you gotta do? Then you put silicone, this is what you pour a body for it?
Yeah, that's the mold, I've painted it in.
That's the mold. So he goes in there, take that little fox. The casket, Amontillado. There you go. Micro Mr. Fox.
You're starting to get a puppet that looks kind of human or sort of animal shaped. From then, you're getting into kind of finishing processes with it. You'll notice on all the characters, they've got little bits of hair at the side or in ears or on eyebrows or on beards. That's all punched in one at a time, just to give that extra little bit of reality. The human characters have got a very realistic skin quality to it, and Bogus is quite pink, but you'll see the sort of broken veins in his cheeks and stuff like that. Quite a lot of work's gone into developing those and getting that look for them. So the hair's a really nice little addition to it. With the animal characters, they've actually got fur as a covering to them. We've had to be really quite careful where we've sourced things from, so everything's come from repurposed backgrounds. So we've got quite a lot of goat and rabbit and a little bit of kangaroo has crept in there as well. For the foxes, of course, they age quite a lot over the show, so he'll start when you see him first as a young fox without any grey at his temples, and then as he gets older he gets little white bits added in, so we'll punch little sort of grey hairs basically at the side of his head. We'll have made the costumes here and adapted most of the costumes here. The design process of that has been evolving throughout the show, keeping the sort of nice shapes and the square shoulders and all those things that Wes likes and asks for. We have to then affect the costumes to fit what sort of things they've been doing. They'll also get dirty from the animators. They get handled, of course, an awful lot. It's like the equivalent of wearing your clothes for a year and then having somebody move them around all over you all day long. They'd soon really get quite filthy. You have to take them off, clean them, and then maybe put back the right amount of dirt to how they should be, and then put them back onto the puppet. So they get quite a lot of wear and tear. You're really, you know, trying to make these things to last or make plenty of spares so we can just keep swapping them over when they run out or break. This is Mr. Fox. He's what we call upstairs a hero puppet because he's capable of doing everything. Inside him is a full ball and socket armature. He's got a foam skin and he's got some silicone hands and feet. He's still got his tail on. This is before he's had his tail shot off by the farmers. But everything's wired and in his fingers so he can do all of the little poses the animators need to do. He can grip things, so he can open and close his fingers and pick things up off the table, grab the chickens, all the things he's got to do in the movie. In the face, he's got a full mech inside here. So this is an exposed mechanism for our hero, Mr. Fox Puppet. So you can pose him around. He's got his eyebrows, you can see there. There's the little paddles that move the flesh on the side of his teeth to give some of the sort of nice little expressions around there. His nose that can move around so he can sniff the air. His little front teeth, so just to get those tiny little shapes around there. And the cheek paddles, so the combinations of all of those things. It does make them really expressive. With the combination of the cheek there, the snarl there, tipping his jaw, tipping his head, you can get all manner of expressions really quite quickly.
These characters look so emotional when you get them in a really tight close-up. I mean, we have our puppets, which are, you know, the puppet heads are this big. Sometimes in a close-up that is just eyebrows to to mouth. And they're obviously, they're not humans, but there is something that you can kind of feel when you look into them.
If what I think is happening, it better not be.
They're constantly developing. There's one character, Jarvis Cocker's character, Petey. We'd sort of built him for what we knew at the start. And as the film's developed, we've needed to give him a bigger range of motion. So we've had to go back into him and then add extra joints and develop his basic sort of armature. It's a development process. They're all like prototypes, which you start with. And as things go right with them, great. And some things you might find that, well, we don't need that, we don't use it. Or some things just need to be changed for a new demand that comes in. So we constantly have to work with that and try and facilitate it as quickly as we can.
I think that these puppets are just amazingly well-crafted and amazing to look at. There's something that kind of brings you into them and, you know, the real textures on them. You're not like looking at a hard sculpted shape. You're looking at something that you know is crafted by hand. And I think that brings in sort of a layer of nostalgia and emotion that is probably hard to describe, but you just, when you see it, you'll feel it.